Good evening, everyone. Thank you for your patience, but there's lots of people that seem to want to talk to Father Freeman tonight. I wonder what that's about. So good evening and welcome to the 2014-2015 Lectures in Catholic Experience. My name is Christina Vanin. I'm an associate dean here at St. Jerome's University, and I am coordinating the lecture series this year. Before we get started, could I ask you please to make sure you've turned off all your electronic devices of whatever sort you might have with you, since we are videotaping this and don't want to hear those. Thank you very much. In his apostolic exhortation, Evangelii Gaudium, or the Joy of the Gospel, Pope Francis speaks about the role and significance of Catholic education for our contemporary culture. In that exhortation, he says, "Catholic schools, which always strive to join their work of education with the explicit proclamation of the gospel, are a most valuable resource for the evangelization of culture." In other words, he says, Catholic education is a critical way through which the church has acted as a mediator in finding solutions to problems affecting peace, social harmony, the land, the defense of life, human and civil rights, and so forth. As we continue to do this work of mediation through Catholic education, Pope Francis reminds us that we must be bold enough to discover new signs, new symbols, new flesh to embody and communicate the word of the gospel. One such sign is the renewal of the rich contemplative wisdom tradition of the Christian church, especially as that tradition is now being taught to children all over the world, including in many of our local Catholic schools. And so we are very fortunate to have with us this evening Father Lawrence Freeman, the director of the World Community for Christian Meditation, a community dedicated to teaching the simple, practical wisdom that has the power for deep personal and social transformation. Father Lawrence is a monk of the Olivetan Benedictine Congregation of Monte Oliveto Maggiore. In 1977, he went to Montreal with his spiritual teacher, John Main, to establish a Benedictine community of monks and laypeople dedicated to the practice and teaching of Christian meditation. In 1991, Father Lawrence returned to England to establish the International Center of the New World Community for Christian Meditation that is present in more than 100 countries. He has conducted dialogues and peace initiatives, such as the historic Way of Peace with the Dalai Lama, and he is active in interreligious dialogue with other faiths. Father Lawrence is the author of many books, including Light Within, The Selfless Self, First Sight, with the subtitle The Experience of Faith, and the book Why Are We Here? In 2010, he was awarded the Order of Canada in recognition of his work for interfaith dialogue and for the promotion of world peace. So please join me in welcoming Father Lawrence Freeman to deliver this year's Waterloo Catholic District School Board lecture entitled Stay Awake, Remembering How Central Contemplation Is to the Life of the Church and the World. Father Freeman.
So thank you, Christina, very much for your welcome, and good evening to everyone. Nice to see the Stratford team here, and meditators from different parts of the area, and welcome to all of you. Well, I've had a few wonderful days of Canadian winter. I started this trip down in Florida, moved to Washington, and even in Washington, I was sitting outside having lunch in my shirt sleeves. Yes, exactly. And 1 hour later, I was up in Toronto and had to borrow protective clothing. But as a Canadian, I feel actually very pleased to be back in the winter, because it's a real winter. You know, the English whine if the temperature goes below 5+. So they don't know what a real winter is. So it's wonderful to be here. This is very much a home for me. And I'm very honored to be here at St. Jerome's. It's quite a few years since I was here last, I think. But it was wonderful to meet with Christina and some of the board members here at dinner, and to hear the wonderful spirit of the university and the vision that is very much alive here and that ties in, I think, to our theme this evening. So I'd like to share some reflections with you about the contemplative life in a secular age in the 21st century. I'll share with you something of my experience of how meditation creates community. I think that insight of John Maine's, that meditation creates community, is a contribution to the development of an ancient tradition, because we've been aware for many millennia of the importance of the contemplative experience. We find meditation at the heart of all the great religious traditions and at the center of the teaching of Jesus, who is clearly a teacher of contemplation. But I think we've often assumed that meditation as the practice of contemplative prayer needed to be associated with solitude as withdrawal, withdrawing from social life, withdrawing from the world, withdrawing from people. And there is an element of truth in that, but I think the solitude that we discover through the contemplative experience is also the basis of relationship. And nothing is more important in our digital age that we remember and stay connected to the dynamics of human relationship, because it is so easy for us to become truly isolated in a negative way in our technological techno-science world. And that's one of the things I'd like to share with you, is the importance of recovering this contemplative dimension in order to moderate and resist the excessive effects of personal isolation and alienation that happen as a result of living in our age of technological miracles. So I'd like to share with you something about this understanding of contemplation in the light of the community that it creates. And I think that is a significant contribution to our understanding of what meditation means. And I've taken this theme of wakefulness because I think that is exactly what meditation leads us to. And it's really what contemplation means. Thomas Aquinas defined contemplation as the simple enjoyment of the truth. Well, to enjoy something for what it really is, so to enjoy the truth, presupposes that you are awake, that you are truly conscious. So contemplation is about the awakening of consciousness and of our capacity to find joy in reality. The Greek word for wakefulness or watchfulness is nepsis. The first letter of Peter, for example, says, "Be awake and of sober mind, be watchful." And this idea of contemplative practice as being about wakefulness, alertness, attentiveness, is at the heart of the Christian mystical tradition. If you look at the Philokalia, or as you might like to call it, the Philokalia, if you look at the Philokalia, you'll find many rich passages from the fathers of the church, the great mystical teachers of early Christianity, about wakefulness, watchfulness, alertness as the necessary condition for our relationship, our discovery of God. That we need to be awake, watchful, and alert in order to see God. And this wakefulness, this watchfulness, this alertness is the result of what they call ascesis. And ascesis is best understood, I think, for us as exercise. When you go to the gym or you do your half-hour walk during the day or you give up sweets for Lent, that is ascesis. It's an exercise that you do in order to be more healthy, more fit. St. Paul speaks about the spiritual life, comparing it to the athletes training in the for competitions. And he said they go and exercise, they train, and the word he uses is ascesis, in order to win this gold medal. And we're doing it for a gold medal or a wreath that doesn't wither. So it's in this context, really, and out of this ancient tradition of understanding contemplation in relation to wakefulness, alertness, and to an exercise, a spiritual work, a spiritual exercise, that I'd like to speak with you. But not just historically. In our community, the world community, for a number of years now, we've been responding to opportunities and invitations to bring the practice, the fruit of meditation, as a spiritual practice, into the secular world. We've understood for a long time, since John Mayne first came here to Canada in 1977, that our essential work in teaching meditation as a way of Christian prayer is to do it by inreach, by reaching into the life of the church, by encouraging meditation groups to form in parishes and in religious centers, religious communities, chaplaincies and so on, hospitals and all. But as that inreach went deeper over the years, of course, when roots go deep, branches begin to form. And the branches begin to develop fruit, and the fruit can be shared. And so as the roots have gone down, we've also seen a branching out of our work in teaching meditation, because facilitated by a wonderful community of teachers, some of you are here, who are able to bring this wisdom of an ancient Christian tradition into the modern world and the modern church. So in recent years, we formed an outreach program called Meditatio that allows us to bring this practice and the wisdom of it into secular institutions, educational institutions, into medicine, into business and finance, and other professional organizations. Now, this doesn't mean we don't also bring, we do, as a major part of our outreach, we bring meditation wherever possible to the homeless, to those suffering from addiction in recovery, to those dealing with mental health issues. So in many different ways, we have discovered, that this simple practice of meditation that takes us to the core of our own humanity touches every aspect, not only of our own lives — those of you who meditate will know what that means — not only does it touch every personal aspect of our own lives, but it can reach out into every aspect of modern society as well. And there is clearly a hunger, a need, and a demand for this contemplative consciousness in our society. I'll give you an example of the sort of the connection that happens. In Ireland, we're running a course with the Royal College of Physicians in Dublin. It's our second year of doing it. We do 10 or 12 day-long sessions during the year for doctors and medical caregivers. And we out of that has come an idea or decision for them to form a faculty of contemplative medicine. And what lies behind that is a growing awareness among quite a large section, I would say, of inspired leadership in the medical profession, of the crisis that medicine as a profession finds itself in today. It's the financial demand of medical care is now threatening to cripple many, many economies. It's a major issue in the British general election, for example, National Health Service. The financial costs are rocketing. Most of those costs are incurred in the last stages of life. It presents many dilemmas, ethical and otherwise. And yet the profession itself is in a crisis of meaning. What does health mean when the very idea of health has been medicalized? When we think of health as something that is delivered, as a product that is delivered and can be bought, and which governments particularly are responsible for providing. As a result of the medicalization of the idea of health, we have situations in which up to 300,000 people die every year in the United States through simple medical error, just making a mistake. Quite a large number of people to die because of medical error. 30% wastage in the medical profession, 50% non-compliance with medication, people who don't take their medication, 50% burnout in the doctors and nurses. So these are serious issues facing a profession that is person-centered, that is driven by the desire, the need to heal, to bring compassionate care and attention to those who are suffering. So this is an example. I could go into more examples of it. But it gives you an example of why a profession like the medical profession is re-examining its paradigms and is seeing in contemplative consciousness, contemplative wisdom, and a contemplative practice like meditation a way of re-centering, of reprioritizing, and of recovering the essential human dynamic of their vocation. Something similar is happening in the business and financial world. A few months ago at the IMF annual meeting in Washington, there was quite a remarkable event, it's never happened in the IMF before, which was a panel discussion with world leaders on the ethics of finance. And on that panel, there was Christine Lagarde, the managing director of the IMF, Sean Hagan, the general counsel of the IMF, the Archbishop of Canterbury, and Peter Ng from Singapore in our community, Philip Hildebrand, and of those panelists, four of them were meditators. coincidentally. And they began their conversation by agreeing that there was an ethical crisis in the financial world, and that that ethical crisis presented huge risks to the global economy and to well-being, because if another crisis of the kind that happened in 2008 occurred, this would be immensely more difficult, even more difficult to control. The fallout would be really disastrous for the world. The last one brought us to the brink, but this one would, the next one would probably take us over the edge. So then they said, well, what are we going to do about this? How do we, because when they speak about ethical crisis, it refers quite simply to the greed and the lack of self-control and the lack of reality that brought about the last crisis. I mean, greed would be the simple explanation. They would all agree that that was the phenomenon that led to the crisis. Greed, which we used to call one of the seven deadly sins that the Desert Fathers understood very deeply. And so they said, well, there's one way we can approach it is regulation. We create more rules. But you can always get around rules. So although regulation is necessary, even more necessary is a new kind of leadership. Inspired leadership. Leadership from depth, from personal depth, and a leadership that encourages a personal transformation in the institute and in the leaders and personnel of these institutions. And meditation came up in the course of the conversation. So what I'm saying is that there are many signs in the way our social institutions are facing their internal crises and the crises of their relationship to the outside world, many indications that a conscious awareness is developing that the solution or the resolution of these issues lies at a deeper level of awareness than we are presently operating on. So that sounds perhaps interesting. But then the next question is, how do we deliver on this? How do we allow, encourage that deeper consciousness, which brings with it both wisdom and compassion back into our institutions? How do we develop that kind of consciousness? Because we live in a rather crazy world. How do you speak to a crazy world? Well, there was a prediction of this back in the 5th century by the desert monks. There's a saying in the desert literature, the day is coming, I think it was St. Anthony of the Desert who said it, the day is coming when the world will go mad. And when they see a sane person, they will point to him and say, he is insane because he's not like us. Well, I think there's a truth in that. How do we identify, how do we respond to this kind of collective and viral insanity? Insane or dysfunctional behavior can very easily be authenticated, justified, institutionalized, and defended, especially if it's producing high profits for a very small number of people. 1% of the world's population owns more than is owned by the other 99%. The Oxfam, I think, campaigned during the last Davos meeting on that statistic. So how do we deal with this kind of insane, dysfunctional, and confused world in which dysfunctional behavior can very easily be defended, both socially, economically? You know, very easily defend the creation of wealth for a tiny number of people at the top by arguing for the trickle-down effect, that wealth trickles down from the top. Well, it doesn't seem to. And the same kind of attitude can also exist, of course, even within religious circles. Insane, dysfunctional distortions and perversions of religious attitudes and religious behavior can also be defended in God's name. So we live in a world in which the crisis of the environment, on the one hand, for example, religious extremism on the other, and our increasingly addictive society increasingly affected by mental illness and depression. According to the World Health Organization, in 20 years, depression will be associated as the second most important contributor to death. So how do we become more awake? And how do we encourage that wakefulness? Do we just retreat into our own personal worlds, into a private spirituality, and defend ourselves from the crazy world outside by simply nurturing our own spiritual life? To do that would be a counterintuitive, counterproductive. We can't really seek God, as Saint Benedict would describe this. We can't truly seek God unless we are able to see in our neighbor life and death. One of the Desert Father sayings is, life and death lie with your neighbor. So your spiritual life or your personal death is involved in your relationship with others. So we can't, I think, retreat into an idea of contemplation which rejects or insulates us from the world around us. We have to see our own spiritual practice, our own contemplative life, which we do need to nurture, spend time on, of course, but we cannot see that in isolation, because otherwise we won't be following an authentic spiritual path. It will become egocentric, it will become narcissistic, it will become everything that we want to transcend. Back in the 3rd century, we find this in the Philokalia, Saint Hesychius said that there are 4 types of wakefulness. The first is calling on Christ for help when we are in a crisis, to call, to invoke the Holy Name. The Christian, I think, can resonate with that, that out of the depths I have cried to you, O Lord. And many people do come to a new level of their spiritual journey and to the contemplative life through suffering, through loss, through fear, through anxiety. The second way of wakefulness that he describes is Hezekiah, being silent and still in prayer. Discovering that prayer is not just about our speaking to God, thinking about God, asking God for things, but that at the essence of prayer is a stillness and a silence, reflected, of course, in the teaching of Jesus himself. As a teacher of contemplation, Jesus tells us, when you pray, go into your inner room and close the door, and there find the ground of your being. The third way of wakefulness that St. Hezekias describes is remembering your death, remembering that you are mortal. One of the things we don't like to think about too much, although St. Benedict says, think about it all the time. Or at least he says, keep it always before your eyes. Not so that you'll become morbid, but so that you will see things in perspective. One of the things that we have lost in our contemporary culture is perspective. And fourthly, he says, in order to be wakeful, examine your thoughts and your fantasies. Know yourself interiorly. So here, you know, from one of the great mystical teachers of the tradition, we have a number of ways in which we can learn to be wakeful. Maybe not all of these are immediately relevant to all of our contemporaries. I think if you go into many businesses or financial institutions, you perhaps wouldn't go through all of these four. But you have to start somewhere. And which of these four ways of wakefulness do you think would be most universal and most acceptable? Which one do you think? If you can remember the four? Yes, I think so. The one that speaks most immediately to people in almost every kind of situation is the stillness and silence in prayer. If we have a full theology, a full understanding of prayer, I think we see it, understand it as the essential therapy of the soul, the essential way of healing, of reintegration, of allowing the self-healing miracle to take place. This is a universal wisdom, that in becoming truly awake in the stillness and silence of our own spirit, we will find the powers of healing and the power of regeneration. The Buddha was once asked, who are you? Are you God? Are you the Almighty One? Are you this? Are you that? And eventually he replied, I am the one who is awake. The word Buddha means one who is awake. Jesus told us that he knew where he came from and he knew where he was going. That's his wakeful authority, his wakeful self-knowledge. And that's why wakefulness is such an important in teaching in the gospel. Could you not stay awake and pray with me for 1 hour, he asks the disciples in Gethsemane. Our tendency is to fall asleep, especially in times of distress. I remember some years ago when I had a very sad loss and felt completely devastated. I think I had the best sleep of my life that night. I just went completely out. It's a natural escape. And we look for different forms of escape. Perhaps the most common form of escape that we seek in our culture is a form of waking sleep. Television is one example of it. But the internet provides many other opportunities. John Maine said that we have to learn as modern people to develop the skill of being both awake and relaxed at the same time. Because when we think of being awake in our culture, we often think of a high state of hypertension, hyperactivity. But that hypertension and hyperactivity becomes counterproductive because it makes us tense and isolated. We have to develop the skill, the contemplative skill, of being both awake and relaxed, as we will in a few minutes when we meditate together. It's this work of meditation, balancing relaxation and alertness, that allows us to begin to practice these types of wakefulness, of watchfulness that Saint Hezekiah was talking about. John Cassian, in the 5th century, teacher of Saint Benedict, and the teacher of John Maine in reconnecting him to the Christian way of meditation, John Cassian warns us against two dangers in our human journey, two dangers that we will also find even on the journey of meditation. And the first of them he calls, in Latin, the sopor letalis, the lethal sleep, or the pax perniciosa, the pernicious, dangerous peace, false peace. John Maine described it as the state of being piously stoned. And I think much of what goes by the name of, well, sometimes by the name of contemplation or prayer today, especially in some more commercialized versions of meditation or spirituality, are really forms of this of these two dangers. But we don't have to take up meditation or pseudo forms of meditation in order to numb our mind, to enter into the state of lethal sleep, complacency, and self-absorption, the pernicious peace. There are plenty of opportunities for that in the media in which our lives are lived out. So we come back to this idea of asesis, the exercise of attention, the life-giving discipline of any true contemplative practice, which teaches us that the essence of prayer is attention, pure attention. The early desert teachers spoke of meditation as oratio pura, pure prayer, pure attention. It's pure attention because we are not thinking about something, we're not paying attention to an object, either an outside object or an internal object of our minds. It's pure because it is non-objectified. So in other words, when we meditate, we're not thinking about God or talking to God or asking God for anything, nor, if you approach meditation from a non-religious perspective, are you thinking about yourself or analyzing yourself? The purity of this way of exercise, of this attention, is expressed in a rather paradoxical statement, again from the desert tradition, by Saint Anthony, that the monk who knows that he is praying is not truly praying. The monk who does not know that he is praying is truly praying. Well, that may need a little bit of unpacking, but the best way to unpack it is to practice it, to understand it for yourself. Meditation is the pure practice of attention that takes us deeper than thought. It's what the Maitreya Upanishad calls the supreme mystery beyond thought. But this same wisdom, the same insight into the nature of contemplation is found throughout the Christian tradition. Ignatius, we call it silence. Ignatius of Antioch says it is better to be silent and real than to speak and be unreal. And Meister Eckhart, of course, said, there is nothing so much like God as silence. And so, we can discover the healing, rejuvenating, and energizing power of contemplation through the work of silence. And meditation is this work of silence. And the work of silence is the work of attention. To pay attention to another person, to a patient that you're dealing with in the A&E, or to a person that you are serving at work, or to your children or grandchildren, or to your spouse or friend, that the attention we give to another person is essentially our capacity for love. Those who meditate on a regular basis, if you were to ask them, why do you meditate? They're not going to say because they levitate 3 inches every morning, or that they develop supernatural powers of prediction or psychic powers. They will much more modestly say, I'm really a very bad meditator. You know, I've been doing it for 20 years and, you know, I'm still a really lousy meditator. So why do you do it? And then you'll begin to find out why they do it. And they will much more modestly and quietly tell you, perhaps, of the changes that have taken place in them, the freedom from fear, the liberation of their capacity for love, their enjoyment of life, and their capacity, above all, for loving relationships. Something happens in this exercise, in this asesis, in this work of contemplative silence that leads us to a wakefulness in which we can see what is there. Beautiful story describing this, of course, is the disciples on the road to Emmaus. Their minds were overwhelmed by grief and maybe even by anger after the death of Jesus. They're discussing Jesus as they walk along the road. Jesus joins them and says to them, hey, what are you talking about? And they say, haven't you heard? So he joins in the conversation, but they don't recognize him. And eventually he opens their minds to the scriptures, to the meaning of what happened to him. But they still don't recognize him. They come to the inn, it's evening, they're going to stay the night. He moves as if he's going on. They call him back. Their hearts were burning within them. They didn't know why. They had the experience, but they didn't understand it. And then he stays with them for supper, and in the breaking of the bread, their eyes are opened, they are awakened, they see him and recognize him. And what happens then? He disappears. Why does he disappear? I don't know. Well, maybe he disappears because, it's whatever the reason that he disappears, because he cannot be seen as an object. When we recognize him, we don't recognize him as an object outside of ourselves. And the sign of that is that you would think the disciples would then be sad, oh my God, I just saw him and I've lost him again. But that isn't how they react. They go back empowered and joyful and full of authority and confidence and live their lives fully awake. John Maine says that as we progress through the spheres of silence, we will encounter the light and the love of the Spirit of Jesus. This is our approach to meditation in Christian faith. And I think we are able, from the power of that experience of recognition, of enlightenment in the light of Christ, we are empowered to take at least some of these ways of wakefulness out into a desperate and hungry world. It is the Holy Spirit who does the work of conversion. That isn't our job. Our job is to share the good news in whatever way we can, in whatever language we can. John Maine says that Jesus has awakened. He has become fully awake and fully conscious of the love of his Father. And we are called to exactly the same consciousness and exactly the same love. So it's out of that experience of meditation in the full wonder of our Christian faith and the mystery of Christ that we are able, I think, to go out beyond ourselves, beyond the church, boundaries of the church, to go out and to share this gift of contemplation with what we call the secular world, just with people out there, with our friends and our colleagues at work and others, with whom we share so much of the problems as well as the opportunities of modern life. Our way of seeing, our way of being awake is culturally conditioned. And we are highly conditioned in our culture by the state of distraction. I think it was Walter Benjamin says, our perception today is a reception in a state of distraction. So we receive things, but we are in a state of distraction as we receive them. We are chronically distracted. We don't know that we are distracted, probably until the first time we sit down to meditate. And then it hits you like a ton of bricks, just how distracted you are. And that's why you need to be introduced to meditation by people like yourself, who also are distracted, but know that they are distracted, and will say to you, well, what do you expect? Do you expect to be the Buddha in five minutes? And to offer us the friendship, the companionship, the support structures, the weekly meditation groups, the groups that are starting in places of work, in hospitals, and in schools. I spent the last few days here in Ontario with school teachers and heads of school boards. Wonderful vision of bringing meditation to the children of Ontario. That's what I think our Christian mission is in a very powerful way today. And I think it underpins all of the other kind of apostolic works that we are called to as well. But we live in an age of fragmentation, of trauma, mental illness, in which our ways of perception, our ways of seeing the world and seeing each other have been so compromised. We've moved from page to screen. We're moving from email to Twitter. We're moving from Google to YouTube. More people now look up things on YouTube than they do on Google. Highly visual, highly distracted, and very short bites, short clips. We have tremendous technology for communication, but we don't know how to use it. What we have to do, and we have to begin with the young because they are the most likely to be damaged, is to recover our contemplative gaze. Not just the quick, fleeting look at the screen or the 40-second TV commercial or YouTube clip, and look at music videos to see just how fast the images are flashing before your minds. We need to recover a contemplative gaze. We need to see that this work of attention is not the same as concentration. This, I think, is of great importance for education. Some years ago, I went to Auschwitz, and it is a brilliantly designed horror run in the most efficient way. It was the product of careful planning, efficiency, and intense concentration and commitment by people who were totally insane, but supported by a society in which that insanity had spread as well. The destructive efficiency of a fanatical focus, not attention. Attention is always life-giving and loving. Attention is always compassionate. Attention always produces wisdom and love. Concentration of that kind produces, like 9/11, the amazing planning for 9/11. You imagine how much technical planning went into that. It produces destruction and death. So we need to teach the difference between concentration that can produce impressive results, but without meaning or goodness, and attention, which will always produce an awakened, loving, compassionate, and wise mind and heart. So we need to teach contemplation. We need to understand the purity of this practice and not compromise it, not dilute it. Not to underestimate, for example, the capacity of children for pure contemplation. I have nothing against mindfulness. In fact, I'm very grateful to it. I think mindfulness has opened the minds of many people in many of our institutions, and has opened many doors for us to bring meditation to people. Mindfulness is a rigorously secular program, and well, it comes from a Buddhist background, but it's teachers of mindfulness avoid any connection with spiritual or religious language or comparison, which is okay. There are people who will need that, perhaps. But I think they're a small minority, actually, in most societies, who have that level of antipathy towards religion or spirituality. What they want is a genuine religion and a genuine spirituality. I also think that even in and in the Buddhist tradition, mindfulness is seen as a preparation, a series of techniques that are a preparation for meditation. And I think any of us here who are meditators would say that mindfulness, being in the present moment, what the doctors call situational awareness, when you're dealing with a patient, in other words, you're in the present moment thinking about the patient you're with, not some other problem, situational awareness, that we would say, oh, this is a natural result of meditation. This is what I've, this is one of the fruits of my daily meditation, is that I do become more present, more attentive, more in tune with the people and the situations around me. I mention that only to emphasize, and I think it's I think many Buddhists would agree with me, the importance of understanding the nature of meditation itself as this work of pure attention, and our capacity, especially as children, but even as adults later in life with more baggage, our capacity to begin to practice it. We only have to begin. That's what John Maine said. Just begin and keep on beginning. He warns us not to evaluate ourselves, not to try to be a perfectionist about your meditation. I mean, I've been meditating for a long time, and I would say I am, maybe I'm not a lousy meditator, but I'm a very, very imperfect meditator. That doesn't stop me meditating. So we have to get over this perfectionism, this idealism, this fantasy that we can be perfect. And we have to understand a very significant difference between meditation and other forms of practice. And that is this difference. There are some forms of practice in which the attention remains on ourself. This can have a temporary effect in calming the mind and making us feel better, and that's not a bad thing. However, in meditation, the effect of the attention is much deeper and leads to a more permanent transformation. And that is because the attention that we practice in meditation comes off ourselves. In meditation, we take the attention off ourselves. And that is precisely what makes meditation so powerful, so healthy for the mind, indeed for the body, and leads to a sanity, a balance, a perspective, and integrity in all aspects of our lives. This is why we need to teach contemplation. We need to see that the attention we practice in meditation is not passive. We're not looking at a screen. It is an interactive attention. This is where our Christian faith comes to illuminate what it is we are experiencing. We come to meditation, we pay attention very imperfectly and find ourselves highly distracted. Nevertheless, it's not 100% distraction, because we are doing this exercise. We are saying our word. I'll describe this a bit later. We are doing what may seem to us a very minimal act of attention in the midst of this whole crazy mind that we have. That may be what it seems like at first. But that tiny little point of attention is enough to make a difference and to start a process. And the process that it leads to is the discovery that we are not only trying to give attention, to pay attention, but we are also receiving attention. we are receiving the attention of God. And the mindfulness of God is Christ, the mind of Christ in us. And it's when we begin to experience this relational attention, this interactive attention, that the full wonder, not only of meditation, but indeed of our whole being, begins to awaken. So I'd like to invite you to take a little time to meditate now. I haven't spoken so much about meditation, we better do it. So you can at least temporarily forget everything I've said. And probably you'll forget it anyway. We'll take a little time to meditate, and then after the meditation, we'll have some time for some discussion or any questions you'd like to raise. Let's stay quiet, but as you've been sitting very patiently, you might like to stand and have a little stretch for a moment. And a good stretch is sometimes the best preparation for meditation. John Maine was once asked, what is the best way to prepare for meditation? And he said, small acts of kindness. So sometimes stretching like this is a small act of kindness we can do to ourselves. Then just take a moment to stand straight, feet on the ground. Feel the force of gravity pulling you down. You can stretch up as well. Relax your shoulders. And just for a few moments, be aware of your breathing. This helps to connect body and mind and begins to help you to take the attention off yourself, off your thoughts. As you breathe in, feel that you are breathing in the gift of life. And because it is a gift, we release it, we give it back, we let go. And that really is a great teaching for us. Every breath we take teaches us the wisdom of detachment, of receiving and giving. Okay, let's sit down. I'll just describe very briefly the way of meditation we teach. First of all, your posture. Try to sit with your back straight, your feet on the ground, your hands on your lap or on your knees, so that you feel both comfortable and alert. So your back straight, relaxing your shoulders, muscles of your face. Meditation is a journey, an integration of mind and heart, journey from the mind to the heart, and an integration of the two. And to make this journey, we simply lay aside our thoughts. Good thoughts, bad thoughts, silly thoughts, wise thoughts. Whatever thought comes up, plans, memories, dreams, reflections, as the thoughts come up, don't fight them or suppress them, but just lay them aside. And to do this, we follow a discipline, an asesis, an exercise, a work of attention, which is also a work of love, which is to take a word, a single word, stay with the same word, and repeat this word continuously in the mind and heart. When you get distracted, just come back to the word. Don't evaluate, just come back, be faithful. Choosing the word is important. The word I would recommend is the word Maranatha, the oldest Christian prayer in the language that Jesus spoke, Aramaic. If you choose this word, say it as four syllables, Ma-ra-natha. na tha. Ma ra na tha. Listen to the word as you say it interiorly. Say it gently without force. Say it faithfully. Keep returning to it. And say it simply like a child. Above all, say it attentively, wholehearted attention. And we'll lead into the meditation with the short prayer that John Main composed. Heavenly Father, open my heart to the silent presence of the Spirit of your Son. Lead us into that mysterious silence where your love is revealed to all who call. Maranatha. Maranatha. Let's conclude with these words of Jesus from the Gospel of Luke. They asked him, "When will the kingdom of God come?" And he replied, "You cannot tell by observation when the kingdom of God will come. You cannot say, 'Look, here it is,' or 'There it is,' because in fact, the kingdom of God is within you. The kingdom of God is among you." So we can take a little time, I think now, if anyone would like to raise any questions or share any brief comments at all. Maybe I'll just get a glass of water.
Oh, there's one.
Oh, yeah. So there. Thanks.
There are microphones, one on each side, if you wanted to come and ask a question.
Thanks. Can give the talk again if you like.
Thank you very much for a wonderful presentation. But I was introduced to the work of John Main back in the late 70s by my then spiritual director up in Sault Ste. Marie, who had a meditation group. Did it for a number of years, and then busyness of life crept in and left, and then restarted again a couple of years ago. The situation of my life is just after we were married, my wife was diagnosed with fibromyalgia, very severe, and arthritic, and lives a life of very much pain. We belong to a very good clinic, which has a multiple practice. And one of the things that they were using was, you mentioned it, mindfulness, which they use for pain control, or one of the things that they recommend. And also, if you know, I think there's a book called Catastrophic Living, where that's much talked about. And so one of the things I've been, or would ask, and have been struggling with, to is the Christian meditation as where does that fit into such things as therapy for pain control? Mm.
Thank you. Well, thank you for sharing that. Appreciate it. Well, I think because we call it Christian meditation, doesn't mean that it isn't meditation, or that, you know, because it's Christian, from a Christian tradition, and we practice it in Christian faith, that means that we don't get the physical and psychological benefits of it. So I think we need to say, if we call it Christian meditation, it's because we're practicing meditation as part of our Christian faith and tradition. In other words, we could say, what makes your meditation Christian? It's your faith in Christ, basically. Faith is about relationship. So you may have a deep or long or not so deep or very recent relationship with Christ. But anyway, there needs to be some kind of faith. Then I think we meditate we can call it Christian meditation because there is a conscious historical and theological lineage, a succession back to Jesus himself. And we feel part of that. Secondly, we meditate in Christ, as Christ, in Christian way, because we meditate within a context of the other forms of Christian prayer and support structures and the scriptures and worship and Christian community. And that doesn't mean that we can't meditate with people of other faiths or of no faith, but it means that that's our natural, that's our home, that's our base. So I think these are what makes meditation Christian, but meditation is universal. The medical and scientific research into meditation began not long ago. 1931 was the first scientific research into meditation. So we have many thousands of years of experimental research and witness to that in the spiritual traditions. Now, through a scientific approach to meditation, we can illustrate and measure some of the effects of meditation that come to us simply through the practice. Now, whether you're a Christian or not, if you meditate, you will probably find that your blood pressure is improved. You know? And God doesn't only give good blood pressure to Christians. So your blood pressure, your cardiovascular conditions, your psychological anxiety and phobias and insomnia and pain, management of pain, all of these are seen scientifically and through research to be benefits accruing through the practice of meditation. Now, there's also research, some limited, much more limited research, into meditation that is practiced within a faith or spiritual tradition. And I can't give you much of that information, but there's not much on it. Most of the research is done in a purely secular, non-religious way. We've done a little bit of research ourselves, some questionnaires, which have been done in a professional way, and basically, in terms of what you can measure or see, it doesn't make, seems, a lot of difference. However, what difference does it make if you are meditating with Christian faith at a human level, in terms of meaning, in terms of a sense of connection? I think there are significantly deeper, more integrated aspects to it. But so in terms of pain, I can refer you to a wonderful member of our community called Mario Leary in Perth, Australia, who is suffering from a number of multiple conditions which keep her in a state of continuous pain and has been for many years. There's a video of a discussion, a conversation I had with her some years ago, which I asked her about her pain, and she said very strongly, very clearly, as did John Mayne actually before he died, when he was in pain at times, that the meditation significantly helped with pain management, or even the temporary transcendence of pain. John Mayne would say, if I can just be allowed to be very still and very quiet, I can go beyond the pain. Mario Leary says something similar too. So I think there's no doubt that the meditation practiced with Christian faith can help pain as it would anybody else, but I would suspect that it also deals with that question of suffering and anxiety that is seen to be associated with pain, but distinct from it. It's another aspect of pain, which is the suffering, the anxiety associated with it. And I think if you bring a whole faith dimension to it, that level of the pain would also be relieved. Okay.
I I had the opportunity to look at the website for your group earlier, and have noticed comments about the nature of the left brain, the right brain, and the way that meditation helps to integrate the portions of the brain. It talks about children being more natively in the right brain, and as we grow older, developing our left brain and then having a hard time putting them together, etc. Are there any books that, I'm not a scientist in this stuff at all, but I'm very interested in understanding that more. Mm-hmm. Are there any that you would point me to be able to explore that understanding better?
Well, there is. There's a book called The Blissful Brain by Shanida Nataraja, who is the daughter of the director of our school of meditation. She's a, what is she, bio neurologist, and her book is very very clear and very helpful. She also has a website in which website I think she develops more of the conversation with the spiritual and faith dimension of it. But in the book, it's a bit more just the evidence. But I think it's very readable, understandable. She's very clear. So The Blissful Brain by Nataraja. And I think what you say about children is very, very true. You see, there was a research project done many years ago, I think by Alistair Hardy, I think it was Alistair Hardy at Oxford. And he was curious about people's childhood religious experiences. And so he just sent out an appeal to anyone, please, if you have any memories of religious or spiritual kind of experiences as children, send them in. Well, he just got them by the sackload. People were pouring it. So he collated all of this. And clearly, we have as children, and I'm sure any of us here, if we began to think about it, would remember moments of where we would say, that later we would say, this is an experience of God, or however you may want to describe it. But what happens, I think, as we get older is that, first of all, as children, we don't have the language for that to describe that experience. And when we teach meditation to children, I think we're always careful not to sort of put, well, to let the experience itself happen, and without asking them to describe it or analyze it, just let it happen, and they will. And then if you're patient and just listen, you will hear some amazing things sometimes from children. Now, if they remain in that practice of meditation as an exercise, as an asesis, as a discipline, from one year to the next, and that becomes part of their life, well, I think it's not likely that they will forget those experiences, and as we often do. And they will also, we will able, hopefully, if we are good educators, we'll be able to help them to put a language to that experience. And that has to be done very delicately and sensitively. That's what faith education in the faith tradition is about, of course. So I think that certainly it does happen with education. We tend to close off one whole side of ourselves and develop the other. Many universities reflect this one-sidedness by their prejudice and fear and antipathy and hostility towards anything religious or spiritual. I mean, there's a definite one-sided prejudice in academia, in many, not this university, obviously, but in many universities. So I think rebalancing that is an essential part of our our cultural challenge and educational challenge today. Sorry.
Thank you very much, Father, for that wonderful presentation. Is centering prayer as effective as your form of meditation?
Yeah. Centering prayer is another expression of the same tradition of contemplative prayer that we're teaching. There are differences in methodology, in the approach, for example, just to be specific, in the approach to the word or to the mantra. That would be where the difference lies. And I think we have to be, you know, clear that meditation or the contemplative path can't really be reduced to a comparison of techniques or methodology. It isn't as if it's a technique that is producing a measurable result. It is at the level of, you know, your blood pressure. I don't know. I would suspect that probably it's Christian meditation and centering prayer and mindfulness would probably all improve your blood pressure. Question is, if you do it continuously, regularly, and so on. But I think in terms of the deeper fruits of meditation, that is grace. Contemplation is always seen as grace. And what lies behind that is your faith. So I think I'm not avoiding the question. I think, yeah, I mean, basically, there's no negative comparison between them. Because what matters is the faith that you bring to the practice. You know, Jesus says, your faith has healed you. So if whatever method we are following, if we're practicing it with pure faith or the deepest and the most faithful way we can, and I would say also that deep faith is related to simplicity, to a commitment to simplicity, to poverty of spirit, to purity of heart, these very, very basic spiritual principles, then what matters is your faith, you know, rather than the method.
I think this is a somewhat related comment or request for your comment. There's been, I think, perhaps a justifiable emphasis on meditation tonight as a Christian meditation. And, 35 years ago when I first met you and your community, I was particularly interested and concerned about that it be Christian meditation. And I think I'm just as much a Christian now as I was then, but I have a very strong suspicion now that my Muslim friends who meditate wind up in the same place that I do. Would you comment on that?
You'd have to tell me what place that is. I agree, of course. Of course. And I don't think that is in any way unorthodox from a Christian perspective. There will be certainly some Christians who would probably burn you at the stake for that. But I don't think that is the official, for example, of the Catholic Church, that isn't the official teaching, is that first of all, we reject nothing that is true and holy in other religions. So there is truth and holiness in other religions. And even as we say in the prayers on Good Friday, we recognize that there are other ways to God than through explicit, you know, Christian belief faith. However, I would go along with this, from a Christian perspective, we would say what the Vatican Council document actually says is that, in other words, you know, you can go to God by whatever route you happen to go. If you live, you know, if you go with integrity and love and purity of heart and so on. But in some mysterious way, is the language, the human journey to God happens in Christ. Now that is a Christian perspective. It would be my belief. And that has to be reconciled with that wider, and I would use the word Catholic, with a small c, universality. In order to understand that, I mean, that may be the theological challenge of this century, we have to really understand the universality of Christ in the biggest possible perspective. So yes, I think we do end up in the same place. We believe there is one God, and we believe we are all his children. And Saint John says it, doesn't he? Whoever loves lives in God and knows God. He doesn't say whoever loves God as I know and love God, but whoever loves lives in God and knows God, and the unloving, even if they believe the right thing. Oh, that wasn't an objection to what I was saying. I've lost it now. It's come back? Yeah. That the unloving, even if they believe the right things, don't know God. So I think it's central to Christian faith that we are not saved by belief. As Saint Augustine said, even the devil believes in God. So we need, I think, to reimagine the meanings of faith and belief in order to address that question. And I wrote a book about that 2 years ago called First Sight, The Experience of Faith, in which I make this distinction about faith and belief. Thank you. Oh, sorry. No? Okay. Good. Thank you. Sit down there. Okay. I always do what I'm told, eventually.
going to ask Derek Kaim, superintendent with the Waterloo Catholic District School Board, to come up and formally thank our speaker on our behalf.
Father Lawrence, this is the last day. You'll have to look at me for a while. We've spent the last 4 days together, and it's been my absolute pleasure. But Father Lawrence, I offer you another Galilean Aramaic word, Yeshar. Yeshar for engaging our minds and imaginations. You're a compelling speaker. Yeshar for offering us a way of addressing our egos. But most of all, Yeshar for speaking to our hearts, for encouraging us to begin and begin again in the prayer of the heart. You invite us to engage in a deeper sense of community with one another. You remind us of John Maine's wise words that meditation creates community. There are many of us in this community who are practicing Christian meditation. You have encouraged and empowered us to come together to change the moral fiber of us as individuals, of other individuals, to change our community, our province, and so on. We want to pray deeper than thought, deeper than words, and deeper than imagination. We want to listen to the Word of God sounding at the heart of creation. We accept your challenge to intervene in all lives, especially in young lives, as soon as possible. Christian meditation is pure gift, and we thank you for inviting us to rediscover a prayer that goes right to the operating system of our minds, our hearts, and our very lives. You might recognize some of these words from the last few days. God bless you, Father Lawrence. We'll pray for you. And I offer you another couple of Galilean Aramaic words, Yeshar Halak, that your strength shall continue to be firm and true. Thank you and God bless you. We hope you'll continue to pray for us as we seek to know God in a deeper way. God bless you.
Thanks very much, Derek. A little bit of business before we finish up the evening. First of all, I want to sincerely thank the Waterloo Catholic District School Board for its support of this lecture. We're grateful for their ongoing commitment to Catholic education and to helping to provide events such as tonight's lecture to our community. I want to remind you to sign up in the foyer if you want to receive the latest information about this series and receive regular emails about upcoming speakers. And you can also, when you sign up on that piece of paper about this lecture series, you can ask, let me know if you want to know about other events and lectures taking place at St. Jerome's this year. Every year, St. Jerome's University is pleased to present a program of speakers to the community. We're able to provide these lectures to the community at no charge, thanks to the generosity of many partners and supporters. If you too would like to support the lectures, I think there are some donation envelopes around here in the hall, but also in the foyer. And I want to continue to say thank you so much to many who have given generously to us. If you missed it on the way in, there's one table that has a number of wonderful fairly traded products available for sale in the foyer, and tomorrow is Valentine's Day, and if you're missing some chocolate or something like that, I'm sure there's lots of good stuff you can get there. You also will find Wordsworth Books, our local independent bookseller, is located in the foyer with books related to our lecture series this year. And beside Wordsworth, you will also find a table with a number of resources from the World Community for Christian Meditation available for sale. And Father Lawrence, who will do anything that I ask him right now, it sounds like, has said earlier, though, that he would be willing to sign. Some of his books are included there, so that's available to you. Wanted to let you know that there's another lecture in a different series happening here, the Bridges Lecture Series. So the next one of those lectures is taking place on Friday, February the 27th, right here in Siegfried Hall. It's going to feature Dr. Stephen Brahms from New York University and Dr. Mark Kilgore from Wilfrid Laurier University. And they are going to be speaking about the relationship between mathematics and democracy. If you want more information about that lecture, there's a poster on the bulletin board in the foyer. As part of, I know a number of you found out, especially those of you who are new to coming tonight, that St. Jerome's University is a construction site. We're under campus renewal, which is very exciting, but also challenging. As part of that renewal, we are raising funds to renew this room that we are in. And our intention is, as part of the whole renewal project, that this room will become the new Notre Dame Chapel. So, in order to prepare for that, we are raising funds. A first fundraising event is going to take place on Sunday afternoon, March the 1st at 2 p.m. We are having a concert of classical, rock, pop, jazz, Celtic music that we're calling Sounds Amazing. The concert is going to take place at St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church, which is on Queen Street North in downtown Kitchener. If you want to find out about that and purchase tickets, which is even better, there are tickets for sale, and they're just around the corner when you pick up the chocolate and all that. Just go around the corner and pick up a ticket to the concert. We are also, when you pick up the chocolate and then the tickets to the concert, then you keep going and you can pick up a heritage cookbook. So, back in 1990, the Mothers Guild of St. Jerome's High School pulled together a bunch of recipes and created a cookbook. And so there are a whole bunch of them left over that have been donated to us. And those wonderful memories are on sale for to you for $5. And again, all the proceeds for all of this goes to the renovation of this room and the making of this room into our new chapel. Finally, the next lecture in this series is going to take place on a different night in a different location. This is our annual Sweeney Lecture on current issues in healthcare. So it's taking place on Thursday, March the 5th, and it's taking place at the Waterloo Inn. Dr. Hazel Markwell, who is the director of the Center for Clinical Ethics in Toronto, and Dr. Donna Ward, who's a distinguished palliative care physician here in Waterloo Region, are going to come together to deliver the Sweeney Lecture this year. Given the Supreme Court's recent decision on assisted suicide, it's especially poignant that the theme for this year's Sweeney Lecture is Death with Dignity, Encountering Patients as Whole Persons. So that evening, March the 5th, begins with refreshments at 7 p.m., and then the lecture itself is going to be just a little bit earlier than normal. It's going to start at 7:15. Okay, so Thursday, March the 5th, up at Waterloo Inn. The St. Mary's Hospital Foundation likes to have, unlike me, I just wait and see who shows up. They like to know ahead of time who might be showing up. So the foundation would really like people to RSVP and let them know if they're coming. So on the table where you can sign up for information, there's a flyer there. It gives you the contact email or telephone number, and you can let the foundation know if you're planning to attend that, okay? That's all the business. The last thing to say is thank you to all of you for coming this evening. And I want to say a special thank you and welcome to a number of you who have traveled from, I hear, from Stratford, London, Toronto. You may be here for the first time, and if you are, welcome. I hope you'll come back. So a number of people from the World Community for Christian Meditation community have come tonight. For all of you, have a safe trip home and a wonderful weekend celebrating the gift of families. So until next time, good night.